So now that I have that, I backed everything up and I can just do selection again. Now this time around, because I changed sort of my estimates of the Q functions along the way, I might want to make a different selection. And so that actually tells us where this original policy comes from. This original policy is just an estimate of Q values that I have, where I happen to feel very comfortable about those Q values. I've visited these states many times. I've backed up a lot of information from them, so I have a decent estimate, and I'm willing to do the kind of greedy policy that is implied by these Q functions.
I see. So we're taking greedy steps down the black part of the tree. When we hit a leaf, then we do the rollout policy, pi r, to get estimates of those different values. Do we now know anything new about the tree?
Yes. And in fact, if we did this, 100 bazillion times or however many number of times we sort of wanted to, we just can say, well, I know the actions that I can take from this node. And so I feel comfortable in expanding my policy all the way down to here for this particular node as well. And when if I did this again, and let's say the selection algorithm had me go here, 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 and I got back to here again, I would actually know which action I wanted to take. Say it ended up with me being here. But then once again, I've gotten to a place where I don't feel comfortable about what to do next, and I would do the expansion and the rollout again over and over and over again. So I just keep doing this again and 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 again. And what this gives me is an ever-expanding tree where I feel more and more comfortable about my Q values and therefore more and more comfortable about a policy that I should take.
And it seems like it's getting more accurate over time.
Yeah, and in fact, if you were at each of these nodes, right, and you took those actions and you did the expansion and you did that, oh, let's say an infinite number of times, and then you did an infinite number of rollouts over and over again, eventually you would converge to a proper Q value.
Cool. That's interesting. So this is a planning algorithm. We need to know the transition model to be able to do those rollouts.
Right. Or you have to have some way of doing the simulation. So when you say you need to know the transition model, you could mean a couple of things. You can mean I actually have the transition model and I can do calculations with it, or you could just mean I have some way of simulating the world and I can just sample from it. So this is pretty neat, right? I think it has some neat little features to it. It allows me to kind of build up a model of the world, do a bunch of simulation and figure out what to do. But there are a couple of questions that should pop out to you, even though I kind of ran over them fairly quickly. I think the first one is, well, when do you stop? What is this actually? I mean, this is kind of an inner loop of a process, right? I'm at this state. I have an estimate of Q values that I'm comfortable enough in that I'm going to take actual actions following the policy that's implied by them, and then I'm going to keep expanding and learning more and more about it. Well, in principle, I could just do that for eternity. But at some point, you have to stop. And when do you stop? Well, you stop when you get bored.
And what do you do when you stop?
Well, once you stop, that's the next question. Well, what do I do after I stop? Well, you execute. You do a sort of one-step policy based upon what you've learned, and then you throw it all away and you do it all over again.
Wait, so you take that step in the world. Do you using the policy, the whole chain that you figured out?
Well, you could, but, and in fact, you can do actually any number of things there. But sort of the simplest version of this is I started out with an empty tree. I'm in some particular state. I'm going to hallucinate all the things that I might do from there. As I do that, I'll be learning more and more about the world. This will allow me to do better and better exploration as I do this kind of Monte Carlo search and simulation and hallucination. And then eventually I learn enough that I know what the right thing to do is from this state, and then I do it. And then I end up wherever it is I end up in the real world. And when I'm asked to do something again, I just do it all over again.
Wow. So it does a lot of thinking each time it takes a step.
Yeah, but it's very fast thinking because, I'm just flipping coins. If I have a fast simulator and I'm able to do addition pretty quickly and maybe some, averaging, I can actually do this estimate fairly well. What's going to impact this a lot is sort of how far down I can go before I run out of computational power. Typically, that's what bored really means. Bored means, okay, I've taken 15 seconds. That's too much time. Or maybe I've taken 3 seconds. That's too much time. It's time to do the best thing that I can based upon what I know. But if I can do that every single time, if I can expand this tree pretty deeply at every time step, then I lose 50 milliseconds. But 50 milliseconds is a long time for a computer and not any time at all for human beings. And the alternative would be to actually explore the entire space and try to solve the underlying MDP. And if you have a whole lot of states and a whole lot of actions, then that can take a very, very long time. So do you take 50 or 200 milliseconds every time you need to take an action? and do it online, or do you take 3.5 months of supercomputing power to figure out the optimal policy and then use that? And the answer is, it depends.